Hi, my name is Storm Glore, and my presentation pertains to music tourism. It's a topic I've been studying for the past 18 months or so, and earlier this year, in January of 2020, I had the good fortune of having three student research assistants to help me out with one part of the research project. This particular part involved identifying the myriad of music tourism assets that are out there and the various ways music tourism happens. What we set out to do is basically put these things into a manageable, identifiable order that is like categories. So really, literally, our question was, how might examples and or characteristics of music tourism assets be categorized? We developed seven such categories, and today I'm going to walk through those seven categories. Now, I certainly don't, think for one second this is correct and this is the right way to categorize them. So at the end of this and right now, I'll say that I certainly appreciate any feedback as to how accurate I might be or if there's any comments that someone might have about these categories. But with that being said, let's get started and I'll walk you through these seven categories. The first one is landmarks. These are physical structures, spaces, or memorials that in some way commemorate some part of music history or some part of its heritage, however small that might be. I'll give you some examples. For instance, Sun Studios in Memphis, or any famous recording studio for that matter, is certainly a physical structure, and with it, there's an immense amount of history. And the site of Woodstock would be another example. Folks go there and make, I guess, a pilgrimage, if you will, to see the site where, 3 days of music changed music history. That would be an example. And then, to a far lesser extent, and I guess I could say a morbid example might be the site where the artist Graham Parsons was cremated. I guess you'd say the old-fashioned way, by some rocks there at Joshua Tree National Park. There are still folks who go and actually visit that spot in homage to Graham. And, it truly is a music tourism destination, albeit a smaller one and perhaps less significant, but not in my book, that is. But anyway, some characteristics of landmark music tourism assets might be that, for one thing, they can still be operating as a business, as a recording studio might still be doing recordings or some sort of studio work. So they're generating revenues in that way. And then there are landmarks that don't generate revenues. You certainly don't pay to see that Graham Parsons site, for instance. Although, to the local economy, it means a hotel stay or something like that that contributes. But nevertheless, there might be direct tourism dollars or not, in admission, that is. But there's social media marketing that can happen with people posting pictures being at these sites, etc. There's publicity that can come from magazine articles or blogs or podcasts about these specific places. And in some cases, they can be considered a nuisance. Perhaps the best example might be the crosswalk outside of Abbey Road Studios in London. I don't know if you've ever been there, but to commuters who drive along that street to get to work, I can only imagine the frustration they may sometimes encounter when somebody's taking way too long to get their picture taken walking across that street or something like that. And anyway, London surely can't shut down that crosswalk. There would certainly be reverberations to that. But nevertheless, they have to maintain it, they have to preserve it in some way, and in some cases they may have to even provide security to make sure traffic still flows as it should with something like that. So in some ways, these landmarks can be somewhat of a nuisance to any extent, and that certainly is a characteristic associated with them. The next category that we'll discuss is live music venues. Of course, pretty much a given, right? Though some people might argue that, you know, there's only a certain amount of visitorship to a live music venue that is local or from out of town, you know, so it depends really on the venue. These music venues would include all types: amphitheaters, concert halls, indoor theaters, bars, nightclubs, any place that plays music quite a bit as part of their business model. There are so many examples, right? You can all name plenty of such establishments, but some distinguishing characteristics or some that might put them in this category include the fact that generally it's ticketed revenues, it's cover charges that contribute to their income, and along with that, these add-on other revenues like alcoholic beverages and merchandise and things like that also contribute to their bottom line revenues. But they also have costs like licensing fees for liquor licenses and things like that, and they have codes that they have to adhere to, fire codes, for instance, and various sorts of regulations. Live music venues are certainly vulnerable to outside circumstances, and we're going through that right now, as many of them and most of them are closed due to the coronavirus. So they're vulnerable, their business model is vulnerable, and they also have potential liabilities involved with the business they're in. For instance, if a patron were to be injured or even worse at their establishment, they could be on the wrong end of a lawsuit, and there are certainly other circumstances that could generate a lawsuit that might happen at their location. So those are some characteristics of the live music venue category of music tourism assets. We talked about this third category, this music nightlife areas idea as an asset that, you know, certainly would include some music venues or many of the most high profile music venues, but not necessarily all of them. These are areas like Beale Street in Memphis or Sixth Street in Austin, Texas, where, you know, everyone knows that these are areas where you can enjoy a whole bunch of various music just walking along the streets there, and you could drop in and out of various locations pretty easily just by parking once and attending those areas. And out-of-town visitors who weren't necessarily there for the music, who might have been there for a business meeting or something of that effect, might also visit those areas too. And these types of nightlife areas, music-related nightlife areas, can certainly, they have their own add-on revenues, that is, to the other establishments that are there. So, for instance, restaurants who are also in the area can benefit from all the traffic generated by the music venues, and other entertainment type venues can thrive by being there, whether they be a comedy house or something like that. Having such an area certainly is a big plus if you want to call yourself a music city. I know we can think of many of the more well-known music cities, and most of them have some sort of area where there's a lot of music happening in one sort of neighborhood or several blocks. Even in, you know, smaller towns, some of those towns recognize those areas as part of their community. These areas, like the music venues that are inside them, are subject to laws and regulations as well, noise ordinances and things like that, as well as zoning and planning that regulations or laws that could affect them. They are also vulnerable in the sense that, you know, the crime rate in the area, if it rises, it could detriment the amount of traffic that comes through the area, the amount of consumers willing to visit it if the crime gets out of hand, and God forbid if there's some tragic incident that happens, there could be a short-term or long-term effect on the traffic as well. The next category that I'll discuss is music museums or exhibitors. These would be Hall of Fames or displayers of any type of memorabilia or artifacts or ephemera related to music in any way or musicians in any way. Some examples would include the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in Cleveland, Ohio, the University of Tulsa Institute for Bob Dylan Studies, a place I'd love to visit sometime, or the Museum of Pop Culture in Seattle. So some of the characteristics that we could discuss when it comes to these tourism assets include the fact that they generate revenues from ticketing and admissions, but they also might have memberships that they sell to these various museums and places like that. They have an education component many times, and they can also be a lead-in to other music tourism activities. For instance, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame could have, it might be a year that they host the induction ceremony, which, you know, will certainly generate a lot of dollars to the local community, or they might have concerts that happen in association with the Hall of Fame there. Certainly the University of Tulsa, I believe it has been the host of a Bob Dylan conference around the fact that they house the Bob Dylan archives there at the Institute. And certainly a Bob Dylan festival would not be out of the question to be held in Tulsa, given this association that they have. So you can see how it could generate some other music tourism activities. One of the downsides is that, you know, these museums could be duplicated in some way or replicated in some way. For instance, if you Google Blues Hall of Fame, you'll find more than one location here in the U.S. for a Blues Hall of Fame. So that, you know, is maybe somewhat of a negative. But there is also the fact that these museums and exhibitors many times have to go outside to seek additional funding to continue operations, be it in the form of fundraising that they do or kiosks that they have at their locations where folks and visitors can contribute some money to them, or, you know, grants and things of that sort that are necessary in many cases to continue operations. Along with these categories I've already covered, I include, an odd sort of category, and that is tourism by association. That's the name I came up with, and this, you know, this category would include communities or places associated with songs or particular musicians or even the lyrics of songs. There are many examples, of these, but I'll go to three of them. And one of them is Winslow, Arizona. If you're familiar with the song Take It Easy by the Eagles, you know about Winslow, Arizona. And that city, you know, recognizes that association. You can go to Winslow and you'll find that there's a flatbed Ford truck parked in a perfect location for a good photo op. There's a street corner there in the town where you can get your picture made with the statue of a guy who's got a guitar with him, and a big sign behind you that says it's Winslow, Arizona. So they have certainly capitalized. If you visit the town of Salzburg in Austria, you will find that in no time you'll be very aware that it's the birthplace of Mozart. There's a Mozart's apartment is there as a tourist attraction, but you also find Mozart walking tours and lots of shops and vendors selling Mozart related stuff. So they have attached themselves to being the birthplace of Mozart in terms of their music tourism, for sure. Leukenbach, Texas, the town that's identified in the title of a mid-70s country hit. Certainly folks who are traveling in that area of Texas and have opportunities to stay in this town, or Leukenbach, they would probably choose that because of that notoriety it has with music. You know, some of the characteristics related to this particular category include the fact that you know, a community could choose, you know, to what extent they really want to exploit that association. The aforementioned Winslow, Arizona, for instance, it wasn't until the late 90s that they really, really took advantage of that association with the song and funded and developed a tourism aspect around there intended to bring more people to the city and generate more dollars. Sometimes these associations can be pretty vague or a real stretch, if you will. I'll use as an example for this the town of Walnut Ridge, Arkansas. Now, Walnut Ridge has a population of 5,000, and you might wonder why they have the Beatles at the Bridge Festival, why they've associated themselves with the Beatles. Well, I'll tell you that my understanding is that one night back in 1964, the Beatles, coming from Dallas on their private plane, found the airstrip at Walnut Ridge as a place that they could land, and actually I think they even changed planes to a smaller plane to get to a remote location in Missouri. So in essence, the Beatles landed at the airstrip in Walnut Ridge one night, and I guess they took off from that several days later. But that's enough to have a Beatles festival in Walnut Ridge, Arkansas. And by the way, it's been very successful, as I understand it, and it's been happening since 2011. So there's an example of a tourism by a very loose association. Nonetheless, it works. The next category I'll discuss is festivals and conferences. Now, you know, music festivals are certainly an important component to music tourism. In fact, if you looked at the all-knowing Wikipedia at music tourism, they simply define it as music tourism is basically going to a music festival. And really nothing more than that from their purview. But music festivals, you know, tend to be, and can be multi-day, but tend to attract a lot of people, right? Now we're talking big numbers. Right, and we're probably talking about a higher percentage of out-of-town visitors to these events. And, you know, some might question the inclusion of conferences into this category, but in both cases, festivals and conferences that are centered toward music, you're bringing a large amount of people together in an association with music. And it, again, could be multi-day. These types of events generate typically a large amount of revenue and a significant amount that, you know, with the tax structure might contribute a lot of tax dollars to the local community infrastructure. They can be pretty big for raising the community profile for a city. If they're hosted, especially if they're hosted every year. They have an educational component. In fact, you know, I listed here as an example South by Southwest, which is a conference and a music festival. So you have that aspect, and then you have, you know, even our own MIA conference, which of course I had to include as an example, you know, is a multi-day thing that can bring a lot of dollars in to the community via something music related. So I should also mention that temporary jobs can be created from the very large festivals as well. But all of these things can be pretty costly too to put together. And that, you know, might be a deterrent to have so many of them, but yet, you know, it can, again, certainly add to the bottom line of community in the form of music tourism. The last category I'll cover really could include any one or all six of the previous categories, and we called it the general music culture. What I mean here is that there are some geographic regions that are visited by tourists simply because of the music culture in general. And I'm looking at you, New Orleans, because, you know, there are folks who go to New Orleans not necessarily to visit one particular venue, and maybe they stay several days to take in a museum a venue, a restaurant, and even just hang out on Bourbon Street and take in all of the music happening all over the city. So there's a case where, you know, it's just probably an extended stay and involves, you know, a myriad of opportunities to be immersed in music. The same thing would go for a country music fan who visits Nashville, right? They can take in so much various businesses and venues that are dedicated to country music in a stay there. So anyway, these, you know, having a general music culture, particularly related to a particular genre, certainly doesn't happen overnight. And that's one characteristic here, is that it certainly requires long-term planning to pull this off, and a lot of consistent support to make it happen. But another advantage is that there are tourists who will come to town, but there are actually people who might move there and become residents because of a well-maintained and well-supported music culture. So that's why we saw the separate need for this particular category. So those are the seven categories of music tourism assets that we identified. As I've said earlier, you know, there certainly could be something we omitted, a category, or we may have miscategorized something. With that also, we may have not really made the correct distinctions between the categories. In either case, I certainly appreciate any feedback or comments that come directly after this presentation or at any time from anyone seeing this as to their feedback or comments or suggestions. I can be reached at the address there, stormglore@gmail.com, at any time with this feedback. For now, I thank you for your time and your attentiveness. Have a good day.